ओम शांति।
ओम शांति।
वेलकम टू द थेरेपी क्लास। आई एम विजिबल एंड ऑडियबल टू एवरीवन।
यस
लवली। सो नाउ कमिंग टू द सिटिंग पोस्चर, लेट्स स्टार्ट द सेशन। Keep your back neck straight, aligned, relax, and gently close your eyes. Go into your posture. Take a deep, prolonged, slow inhalation. Deep, prolonged, slow exhalation. Inhale and exhale. Be attentive towards each and every single breath. Now, inhale for the three time I'm chanting along with Shan. Inhale for the Om. Shanti, shanti, shanti. Feel the vibration and sense. Join your both palms, tap your palms. Ease on your eyes. Very slowly while blinking, looking at your palm. Gently open up your eyes with a great smile. Say Om Shanti. So, in previous session, we talked about arthritis and all the diseases of related to the bone related problems. Yes, and we talked about the treatment and the treatment related to the arthritis and the osteoporosis and other bones related problems like calcium deficiency, or maybe sometime your body would not be, you know, able to absorb the nutrition in that condition. Again, certain kind of, you know, if you change the diet, again you can transform your body and improve your dietary, and you can absorb the nutrition from the food. Okay. So today we're gonna talk about the practice, how you can help with the asana and the breathing practice and the meditation. Okay, so yesterday I think we talked about everything in detail about the diet. Only one difference, like if you're treating for the osteoporosis and rest of the bone problems, they can have the yogurt. Yes, again I'm repeating it, but any kind of arthritis, you should avoid, boycott the yogurt and curd and all the cold things. Okay, they completely, you know, boycott in their diet. They cannot have it. So, how through the asana, how through the, you know, certain practice, body movement, what they can do, how we can help them. So there's a name. I'll pause the video and I'll write it down for you. It's called Sushmyam or Pavanmukh series also. Vyam. Sushmyama series, or it's in Hatha Yogi text, Asana Pranayama Mudra book, mentioned in the series. So one thing, when somebody is having the arthritis or somebody is having the bone related, their bones are very fragile, you know, joints and ligament and the muscles also gonna weaken that area. For example, I have, this is my bone structure, right? So in my finger, there's a joint here. So once it's gonna inflame, it's not gonna inflame the bone, but it's gonna inflame my fascia, the ligaments and the tendon around this area. Right, everything, and then it's inflamed, and it's I don't have the lack of the, you know, it limited my motion. So diet, yes, you have to take it, and then what you can do about it. You cannot teach them, okay, go for the Stanga Vinyasa series or do the fast flow yoga or the acro yoga the Vinyasa or other forms of the yoga. And other styles of the yoga, they cannot perform it. So you have to modify all the, you know, series. They cannot practice these normal asanas, especially the people of who are having the bone related problems, osteoporosis. Their bones are very weak. You cannot make them to do, okay, do this consultation fast mode, power yoga or something, Bikram yoga. You're gonna teach them. No, put therapeutic yoga. So simple. A yoga you're gonna introduce them. Simple Sushmyam. Sushmyam means subtle movement of the body. Subtle movement means this is the movement. It's called Mani Bandh Shakti Vikasa Kriya. Okay, there's a name. There's more than 55, you know, practice where you walk on the each level of the joint. Like my neck movement, this is I'm working on the pivot joint, right? And my neck would be gonna flexible more. I have the arthritis in bones, right? And then other problems. So I cannot move my neck in the fast mode. So I would be doing with the awareness of the breath. And then I'm moving my neck left to the right, right to the left. It's called also neck rotation, neck exercise also. But people, you know, they do the very fast. In Pavanmukh series and the Sushmyam, you have to, you know, understand these things. Griva Shakti, it's called in Sanskrit, Griva Shakti Vikasa Kriya. Griva Shakti Vikasa Kriya. Even if you don't remember the name, that's okay. But understand how you're going to practice. Okay, that I'll just tell you. I'll show you through the neck and then it's implement to the rest of the body part. No matter you're going to move your elbow up and down, flexion and extension. It doesn't matter if you're doing the, you know, the circumduction with your wrist. That is again. But how you're going to move, that's that I'm going to show you. So I start with the neck. Understand it called name. If you want to remember, that's good for you. And Griva Shakti Vikasa Kriya. Griva Shakti Vikasa Kriya. So here three practice you have to do. Up and down, like you're going to move your neck up and the down. So what I'm doing, I keeping my neck neutralized and then inhale As I exhale, going down. Inhale. Inhale. Or inhale, left to the right, right to the left. Exhale, try to see at the back of your body. Part two. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale. Inhale, exhale. Now part three, Griva Shakti Vikasa Kriya part three, rotation. Inhale. As you exhale, bring your neck front. Exhale. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale. When you're inhaling, take your neck back. As you exhale, bring front. Exhale. Inhale, opposite direction. Exhale. So these are the three practices related to the neck that called Griva Shakti Vikasa Kriya part one, part two, and part three. And make sure there is a precaution one has to take, that you have to aware about the movement. When you move your neck, you should be consciously moving. It's not like that, no? It should be conscious awareness towards the movement. You have to observe how my neck is moving from front to the back, okay? And what happened when you're doing its work on the deeper level of the, you know, your tendons, your fascia, your ligament around your the bones and your joint. So your joints moving with the very conscious level. And then there's a prana which stops. Basically, those bone-related problems when the joints are stuck or fused together, or there's no much mobility available, or there's a lack of the fluid or lubrication in the joint, it happened because of prana is stuck there. Okay. In order to release the prana, you have to practice the Sushumna more. And when you are practicing more with the awareness, with the attachment of the breath, prana gonna release, and then you, hence you get the mobility. I hope this much is clear to you. Then many patients, they feel the, you know, fingers. First, whenever they get the attack of the arthritis, it starts from the finger. So there's a one more practice I'm going to show you. There's a, you know, huge series available. So if you get the chance to learn those things, you have to, you know, look for those school which teach these series. Sushumna, okay? So I'll show you the one more practice which is very helpful for the people. That is called Anguli Shakti Vikasa Kriya. Anguli Shakti Vikasa Kriya. So you have to keep your hand like this. So, okay, it would be the straight, and then you are making the like a claw like this. Okay, making the claw and then making up and down like this. So keeping your fingers straight, This you're going to practice in the standing position, and also you can use in sitting position. But you have to make sure eyes are open. But when you're doing in sitting position, you can, if you want to close your eyes, you can close your eyes and go into the deeper level of the, you know, movements of your finger or even the rotation of the neck. But that needs to be careful. Standing position and sitting position. Both we do, but when you're standing, keep your eyes open. When you're sitting, you can twice. You can make the choice, either closed or either open. So making the close and then opening up. So you have to feel like pressure. It should be like, so when you're making the close, you can feel the, you know, pressure in your phalanges, these areas, phalanges joints, each joint. This is the one practice of the Angli Shakti Vikriya. So you can start with the 10 or 15 times. 1, 2. So slightly, you have to feel that something you are holding in your finger. And even it's really good practice for the carpal tunnel syndrome that happens for the people who are doing the typing or pianist or guitarist. Their fingers become numb and they feel that tremendous pain in their finger. That is also, they can do this practice. Then this is the one practice. Second practice, you have to keep your hands free and make the claw and pull towards you. You can feel the whole muscles would be activated from finger, from tip of the finger to your, you know, radius and ulnaris muscles till your elbow and your bicep and tricep muscles would be activated. And you feel the, you know, your ball and socket joint, this joint also you activated by doing this simple practice. Even your shoulder blade gonna open and you feel the, you know, your chest would be more open when you're doing this practice. So how you're gonna do? Inhale. As you exhale, inhale and exhale. In exhalation, you put more pressure. You feel the little bit pressure on your fingers and your full arms. Okay. These are the two practices is very beneficial for improving the blood circulation around your these nerves. And these are the very simple practices. You have to observe what level, you know, they reached, especially in arthritis, stages they have reached. So too much information, so simple these things they do. If they can more, you know, mobilize their hand and they can able to do this more. So according to that, you have to modify. Then Mudra Shakti Vikasa Kriya, rotation of the wrist, again keeping your hand rotating one by one or the both things together. Make sure what you're doing, you have to inhale and exhale very slowly. You have to observe the movement of the wrist with the closing eyes or keeping the eye open. That to you. Okay, that Mudra Shakti Vikasa Kriya. These three practices is really wonderful, which working on the of the body. And then come to the knee joints, Janu Shakti Vikasa Kriya, Janu Naman, or Janu Matlab knee related exercises. Knee related exercise, it doesn't mean you the push up or something like that. It should be the very simple with the lots of breathing when you're moving your knee. When you are moving, so up and down, you can do this practice, or Dandasana, Dand position, you can move your leg up and down, flexi and dorsiflexi movement you can make when you're sitting into the Dandasana. I think all of you know what is a Dandasana. So Dandasana, flexi and dorsiflexi movement, which happening to your ankle, that's give you the, you know, blood circulation. It increase the blood circulation around knee. So then gulf padanglish shakti vikriya, where you're moving your fingers of your feet, big toes and tiny toes, again up and down, like forward and plantar flexion and dorsiflexion. That you can do. Then one more with the ankle, also you can do the rotation, and with the up and down, like forward and backward, like this. So with ankle, with same do with the leg, like we do with like with our hands. Same thing you can do with feet, that improves the joint mobility. Now, as I also explained, arthritis gonna infect your hip joint also, your back joint also. So all the posture like Manjariasana, cat cow pose is very good for improving the flexibility of your spinal cord and spine. And hip movements, you can do the Shironi Chakra. Shironi Chakra means when you lie on the supine position on the back, and then move one leg in the air, making the zero, like make a big small O, and then gradually make the big O. That Shironi Chakra we call. That also improves the flexibility of your hip joint, and it's also good for the hip opener exercise. Like if you have the rigidness, stiffness around your hip, it's gonna help you to improve the mobility of that area. Then a little bit forward and backward bending is also helpful, but make sure a little bit. You have to see their motion, their range of the motion, how much they can go forward. There should not be a pressure, too much pressure. So little bit movement, like sidewise kati chakra, kati ki kriyai. Kati kriyai means the waist movement, where you are twisting your back in the standing position. Any simple, up and down with the arms, this thing, or this, Poon Bhuja Shakti Vikasa Kriya, this one you can introduce to your student. Then these simple breath, it's not difficult. Don't make the difficult, don't give them the difficult posture where they give the intense tension and intense pressure to their joint. That you have to keep in your mind. Slight movement from every part of the body, they can practice. And you have to also go through that according to the patient. Okay, which stage they are. Some people, those who are in the stage of, the arthritis is very much aggravated. They stop walking. They cannot, move at all. And their bones are very, very fragile. In that condition, start with the breathing. Okay, don't introduce the movements first. Start with the breathing. So this is the small 30 to 45 minutes they can do this movement with the awareness of the breath. Then you can introduce to the breathing. Safe practice. So write it down, the breathing part. This much you understood the movements, the Sushmyam and the Pavan Mukti is. Everybody? Any doubt here? Okay, good. So, next, if somebody, in aggravated condition, you don't know what to do with them. Maybe it's in your family. Maybe they are not coming to your class. Okay, make sure they are not coming to your class. So how we can help them? Yeah, there is not much thing you can do about it, but understand everything is related to the prana. Your lack of your joints affected, your muscles affected, your ligaments affected, all the diseases, whatever diseases come to you. If you work on your breathing pattern and you improve your breathing and you maintain the oxygen level in your body. So even I experiencing, I think 90% problem would be, you can sort it out by yourself. Do anything, but you work on your breathing pattern. Okay, I'm not talking about the pranayama yet. Okay, pranayama is to take lots of precaution. I'm talking about the breathing, pre-practice of the pranayama. So make sure you are not using the pranayama, because for that you have a deeper understanding of the pranayama. Pranayama would be dangerous if you're introducing just like, okay, start doing it. So you require the deeper understanding, you require the self-practice, so many things. So you are not supposed to introduce the pranayama to anyone. And especially you are not training that right now. You require many, many years of practice and observation. So how we can help them? If somebody's come, even these people also, those who are having the mild arthritis, the mild related bone problems or bath related issues, how we can help them? So the first is teach them the abdominal breathing. I hope you learn this abdominal breathing. So abdominal breathing along with the kumbhaka, antara kumbhaka. So you have to inhale, give them the kumbhaka, antara kumbhaka 5 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 seconds only, not more than that. Or 2, 3 seconds, depend how much they comfortably can hold their breath. Okay, that's it. Well, don't introduce the kumbhak if their breathing pattern is not correct. It means you have to observe them, how they are doing the breathing naturally. I mean, how they learn the breathing. You have to observe them. It means when they inhale, their belly should be pop out. Their lungs would be, you know, expanded, ribcage is expanded. And when they exhale, the contraction happens in their abdominal region and diaphragm moves up towards the lungs and lungs go into the contraction. It's like squeezed. So you have to correct this pattern. This is the right way to do the breathing. Once they learn it, I don't know, it depends person to person. Many people take 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. They don't learn it at all because they are not practicing. So first you have to teach them the right pattern of the breathing. And then afterward, you have to introduce the abdominal breathing. Abdominal breathing where you have to inhale full belly and like a little bit is like belly should be come out properly. It should be complete pop out your belly. And when you exhale, belly goes in. This is the way you have to practice the abdominal breathing with application of after, I think 1 week or 2 weeks, you can introduce the antara kumbhaka or maybe the 1 month. You have to observe that person, how he's doing with the abdominal breathing. Like he's able to move his belly, you know, up and down. That you have to observe. You should feel the connection with the movement of his lungs, his diaphragm, and his abdominal cavity. Okay, he has to feel that movement. If he did this thing, then make sure. After that, you gonna introduce antara kumbhaka, retention of the breath. So inhale, hold for 5 seconds, or the 2 seconds, depend person to person how comfortably, or 6 seconds, but not more than that. And then very slowly, deeply, very slow as he can go, exhale. Inhalation should be again with very slow pace and exhalation also with very slow pace has to be done. And retention only 2 to 5 seconds, that's it. Not more than that, not less than that. In between, yes. Because kumbhak is not suitable for everyone and that's why it required so much, you know, observation and so much precaution. 5 and 2 is safe version. Everybody can hold that. Okay. So abdominal breathing, when they learn abdominal breathing, then move to the chest breathing, thoracic breathing, okay, diaphragmic breathing. These other practice you can introduce to that person. And then after that, yogic breathing. When he get the mastery over abdominal breathing, thoracic breathing, diaphragmic breathing, then you're going to introduce the yogic breathing. Three part of the breathing. That's abdominal, thoracic, and clavicular from here. So these are the safe practice. Then after that, Nadi Shodhan should be introduced. When they get the perfection on three, then Nadi Shodhan. Nadi Shodhan has a tremendous benefit. Tridosha Nasha. No matter what kind of problem anybody has, they should practice the Nadi. It's safest thing, practice. And it is the pre-practice of the pranayama. And it's opening the all the channel, the nadis of your body. All the pranic channels where the, you know, prana, the energy is flowing. So it's going to clean and purify all the pathways. And then prana going to move, energy going to move in each and every body corner. And then you come out from the all kind of problems. Bone-related problems, arthritis, osteoporosis, rickets, bone-itis, it means cancer of the bones. So no matter whatever problems you are, you can come out from by doing these simple practice. I hope you understand these four breathing, rest of the breathing in pranayama, now meditation bath. This much you understood what you're going to do with the breathing bath. Any doubt you have? Lovely. So now come to the meditation. Vata people have the difficulty to sit for, you know, they are having lots of thinking. All the time they are agitated, anxiety, full of anxiety. They cannot sit and do the meditation. You cannot make them to perform the passive meditation. It's very difficult for them. They cannot practice the Anapan meditation. Yes, Saloni.
One thing in Nadi Shodhan also retention we can add.
Yeah, you can add. You can apply the 2 to 5 seconds of Antara.
Okay.
So
beautiful dog. I miss having my dog. Yeah. My dog died about 6 months ago. So yeah, I haven't got another one, but I miss dog company. Is that one your, which one is your? Oh,
how it's related to,
she
this
looks class. Like from the RSPCA or something. Yeah,
who is speaking? Monica, you're speaking us or to somebody?
What's
Monica? You're speaking to us? I have to. I can move. Okay. So, meditation part. Meditation part plays very important role. Understand the mind of the Vata people, okay? Everything is started from the mind. Okay, it's not like they born, some people born with the arthritis, they dream, but it trigger when you do the something wrong with your body. It is in the code of the cells, but it doesn't mean that you're going to have that problem. So genetic problems basically trigger when you do something wrong with your body. It means taking too much stress or taking wrong diet or within doing the sedentary lifestyle, following the sedentary lifestyle, and not happy with your work, anxiety, frustrated, angry, always. And this gonna trigger the genetic disorder, genetic problem. So if you do the meditation, right, if you choose this path, especially the yoga path, the meditation, everybody has to do. There is no way, chalo hum nahi karenge. This is not for me. No. That's why we have the varieties of the meditation. We have many, many techniques of the meditation. Okay, you cannot do this kind of meditation, do another kind of meditation. Okay, it's not suiting this meditation, you don't understand, do another mode of meditation. But required to practice the meditation. Or am I wrong? Meditation, actually, we are not doing the meditation for concentration technique. At least these people, even you are not looking for the, you know, people say, I'm not looking for the moksha and becoming the yogi. Why should I require these things, the concentration and these things? In order to keep your body and mind, you know, at the peace, you require some concentration technique. It's like, you know, discipline for your mind. How you discipline your body. Like even simple things, whatever you do, your body sets the memory, like making the tea is a discipline for your body. Driving the car, riding the bicycle, or anything. How you are comfortably doing with that thing, because it becomes your practice. You make your body disciplined, right, in that. So you require same way the training to your mind. But about the mind, and we focus on the body, right? So also require certain kind of discipline, right? So concentration will give the mind, okay, this is your aim. You have to work on that. Just face on this duration of the time. Be there and don't go anywhere. It's like giving instruction to the child. And then, first time it's not going to listen, but eventually it's going to, like how you teach your children, okay, this is the time for your study, do this thing, and later on, we go for the playing together, right? Same way you have to teach your mind. So this concentration technique is going to help you to make your mind disciplined. So you're given the set of time, set of the duration, and set of the isolation, you choose the isolation place for doing the meditation. Then your mind gets the idea, oh, now I'm going to certain things. Okay. So all the diseases started from this. So you require the function, you cannot get therapy. Yes. Diet, the vyam, the asana practice, the breathing practice, along with the meditation and the concentration. Okay. So these people, what kind of technique they should use for concentration? So passive technique would not be working for them. Passive means sitting, sit and do something. No, it could not work for them because their mind is a little bit, you know, so much agitated and full of the thoughts comparative to the rest of the personality. So we can give them something which is like pranav, chanting medium, where they can, you know, chant the Om, yog nidra. I'm gonna teach you we have this in the coming session of the meditation class. So yog nidra they can practice, and they can practice also chanting the pranav meditation, akar, ukar, makar, and amri, all the four. Then Om Namah Shivaya chanting, then Om Mani Padme Hum also they can chant. Anything which is required them to engage themselves, right? Anything where they have to chant or something they required outside of, not inside, they cannot focus on inside. Something very loud object they require. You know, there are some people who go and observe the tiny dot. But some people, they require the big object to see. So same way, for these people, we require the very big object to concentrate, to improve their concentration. So very loud they require. So that's why chanting, not Ajapa meditation gonna work for them, but very loud where they can listen and keep chanting, kirtan, where passive active meditation, where they do the dancing little bit, you know, dancing, and then they're moving their body, and then they are chanting, doing the bhajan, kirtan. These kind of meditation gonna work for the Vata people and all the problems to the vata related category. Okay. So, and if kirtan also good for them, and also listening the music is very peaceful for them. And whenever they go for sleep, they can do the yoga nidra. Yoga nidra will, you know, improvise their sound sleep, because they have the sleep apnea, they cannot sleep very well. So these all the things they have to follow along with the diet, very much important. And yes, eventually within a 4 months you will not see the results. Yes, it required the longer period of time, but yes, it depends person to person. But 4 months, if they do like make this thing ritual morning and evening 2 times in a day, they are practicing regularly, I think they can sort it out, problem arthritis, they come out, or maybe they cured themselves completely. Depend person to person. Curing happen within yourself. If you want to cure yourself, you have to fully dedicate your life towards the practice of this routine. So they can cure also by themselves, by following strictly this routine, this general routine. Any doubt will have any doubt.
One thing you said, passive and active. Can you explain again about the meditation?
Okay, passive and active meditation. Basically, passive meditation where you are not doing much movement, though to the mind. But Asian yogis, they believe when mind is completely silent, right? Completely silent. That is a passive meditation. But modern yogis believe that if you're doing the sitting meditation, like sitting and you are doing the like breath awareness and you are observing the sensation, or you're doing the ajapa meditation, reciting in your mind, that is a passive meditation. Okay. But Asian time, the Asian yogis meditation where mind is completely silent and it focused on the only one thing, like anapan we did, this is the passive meditation. Anapan, all the, you know, stages are the passive meditation. Active meditation, where you require the movements of the body, where you do a little bit dancing and like any kind of movement, or talking or chanting loud, where everybody is involved. So these are called the active meditation. Yeah.
So you are telling that active is good for these people, or like, yes. Because, yes. But what about like pranav chanting? But you also chanting suggested pranav chanting and all. You also suggested yoga nidra, Gayatri mantra. So this is what we do regularly, like in sitting posture. So so this is also there, or
go with the. Don't confuse your mind with the sitting posture. Saying where you require the talking. In chanting, okay. When you're chanting loud, it becomes active. When you're chanting with your mind, it becomes passive.
Okay.
And there's a stages of going into the passive meditation. And there's a stages of going into the active meditation. So chanting loud, chanting, and then you go into the dancing mode, you're chanting, you're jumping, right? So you're going from the outward. Like more active, and then you're chanting, then you're going inward, you're going towards the passive side. Now your mind is start chanting, now you stop talking, you're not chanting loud, you're chanting within your mind, and then slowly you're not chanting at all, you are just there. That is a passive stage you are reaching. Are you getting it?
Okay, now get it. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Yes, then.
Hello, I missed some of the chants that you recommended. I caught Om and Om Mani Padme Hum, but I missed the others. I wonder if you could repeat them, please.
You missed the names of that?
Yes.
You're asking me the names of the meditation, which they can practice.
Yes, please.
So, like Gayatri Mantra, Om Namah Shivaya, Gayatri Mantram Namah Shivaya, which I also introduced in the meditation class. So you can see my pre-recorded videos, which is available on the YouTube. So Om Namah Shivaya, Om Mani Padme Hum, Gayatri Mantra, Pranav Meditation in Pranav Akar, Ukar, Makar, and the Am chanting. Okay, these are the all the chanting which I introduced to the in the meditation class. So these practice they can do when they are having certain these bone related problems and vata related issues.
Lovely.
Then it's clear.
That's clear. Yes, thank you.
So tomorrow we're gonna take the complicated problems about the asana, sinus, and yes, vata also play role in that asana. But tomorrow we take all the problems which is related to the kapha. 26th date would be the last day of our classes of the therapy, and after that you have to submit the assignment. I'll give you the assignment on 26th. So and 26th we would be covering the pitta kind of problem, all the pitta related problems and diseases associated with the pitta. So also understand 26th, 27th, 28th, 29th, 30th. So 4 days you will, 3 to 4 days you have for the submitting the assignment. And so prepare yourself. It would be whatever I taught to you, the assignment would be given on them related to that. And you're going to submit me on the 30th. Okay. So this 4 day, I think, sufficient for you to prepare yourself for the assignment. And the assignment should be on the two class I'm conducting, that is the meditation and the therapy and Ayurveda. So these two classes, I'll give the assignment related to whatever topic we covered. So, so we're going to end the session here. I hope you understand everything and prepare yourself. I don't want to give you the surprise. Assignment. You submit the assignment and 26 is the last day for our therapy. So don't miss the class. And if you miss anything, you can see all the topics available on the YouTube and pre-recorded version of the Zoom is available on the YouTube channel. So much. Bye-bye. Take care. Bless you guys. Om Shanti.
Thank you. Om Shanti.
Thank you. Namaste.
Namaste, dear.